Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
You're all very welcome this morning. The first hymn is in the green book, and it's number 121. Please stand.
Lord, have mercy.
Like the disciples behind the as your followers. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Now on page 2, we pray together. Almighty God, our heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and against our neighbor. In thought, in word, and in deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by the Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. Shall we stand now to say together the words of the Gloria on page 3? Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit, in the glory of our Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the door of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk in the joyful road of sacrifice and peace, to the praise of God the Father. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for our 3 readings. So for 3 readings, we'd like to come forward now. That would be wonderful. Thank you so much.
The first reading is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 32 to 35. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions. But everything they had owned was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them, and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It is like a dew of home that falls upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has ordained the blessing, life forevermore.
In Christ there is no east or west, in him no south or north, but one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide world. Please stand as we sing together number 480.
Thank you.
first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called Twin, one of the 12, said, "I will not believe." A week later, the disciples were again in the house. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Christ.
Still danger everywhere. danger from the Jewish temple authorities, and danger from the Romans. And let us remember that of those first apostles, most of them were martyred. So how has this extraordinary change taken place from this group of men locked behind doors in a room for fear, to this open community, community of the resurrection? How has that happened? Come back with me to the closed room. When Jesus appears to them, something changes in their hearts. Gradually they come to realize that actually death has been conquered by the resurrection of Jesus, then ultimately nothing can separate them from the love of God. Nothing can separate you and I, the baptized community, the community of the resurrection. Ultimately speaking, nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not even the roadworks going on Autostrada A18, which I gather is causing havoc for the local inhabitants of Tardina, causing much discussion. Not even that can separate us from the love of God. Furthermore, if through Jesus' death on the cross, sins have been forgiven, then even Peter's threefold denial of Jesus will not cut off, as we see, from the love of God. But the penny doesn't drop straight away. As we've seen, the disciples are still fearful. Jesus has appeared to them once in the locked room, but when a week later we still find the bars of that door locked, what has happened? It's taking a long time for them to realize actually what has happened. They are still a fearful, isolated little band of disciples. It takes them a whole lifetime, it takes us a whole lifetime to come to discover that ultimately nothing can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I imagine Jesus, if he'd appeared to the disciples in Italy, behind those locked doors, he might have said, "Ciao." He might have said, "Ciao." "Hi." You see, it takes, the lesson begins with a simple "peace be with you," with a "ciao." And it takes a lot longer before it's time for them to learn the Italian subjunctive. Jesus starts with a simple lesson, "peace be with you." A long, long journey between Jesus' first appearances and the fully fledged church post-Pentecost. And even then, we remain fearful and doubting. Margaret and my family and I were up on the hill. And we were looking over to Etna last week. But it was shrouded in clouds. We couldn't see the great mountain for the mist. On other days, like today, Etna is visible and visibly eruptive. Believing and trusting that God is still there when behind the mist and the clouds is what faith is about. Even there, when Etna is hidden behind the clouds, even when God appears absent to us, he still burns like a blazing fire, like a mighty flame, as we read in Song of Songs in the Old Testament. Jesus, God, is a blazing fire. Often we don't feel that and apprehend that, but he still is a blazing fire, even when hidden to us, even like when shrouded in the mist. So let's just stay a moment longer in this locked room where the disciples are. Locked room. Lock down. Brings back dark memories we would wish to go away, does it not? My memory of the pandemic lockdown was that my soul was gradually shriveling up in that isolation. I only came to realise it after some many months of being locked down. When we are locked down, or when we lock ourselves down, as those disciples did, something human in us starts to die. Jesus appears behind the cloud, perhaps, and the disciples are full of joy. But we mustn't forget Thomas. Thomas doubts because he wasn't there on the first occasion when Jesus appeared and said, I'm only going to believe I can put my finger in his wounds, in the nail holes, and my hand in the side where the spear pierced his side. I'm only going to believe if I see the physically risen from the dead Jesus. Week later, still behind those locked doors, still a fearful little band of disciples, Jesus appears, and Thomas falls on his knees and says, my Lord and my God. Now in English the word Lord is a slightly odd word these days, isn't it? And Signore in Italy, we use here in all kinds of different circumstances, perhaps when just ordering the food in the restaurant. But we need to lay hold of what Thomas was actually saying when he said, my Lord and my God. Caesar's Augustus, you'll remember from the nativity narratives of Jesus' birth, Caesar's Augustus declared the year of his birth to be good news and declared himself to be God in incarnate. He declared himself to be curious, to be Lord. So when Thomas says before the risen Jesus, my Lord and my God, he's saying, you are above all, emptied himself of his glory, became an obedient to the will of his Father, emptying himself and becoming obedient even to death on the cross. And it's for that reason that he is declared by the New Testament martyrs to be Lord. So Thomas's confession, my Lord and my God, is both deeply personal to him and is a cosmic acclamation of the authority of the risen Christ. Now fast forward me into imagination, please, to this other reading we have from 1 John 1. There we find John saying that we are the ones who have heard and seen and touched the crucified risen one. And we now proclaim to you, our readers, our listeners, we proclaim to you two things. We want you to have fellowship with us. We don't want to be isolated. We want to be in deep fellowship with you wherever you come from across this globe. The second thing they write is, we want our joy to be complete, and our joy will only be complete when we are united in fellowship with all of you. So a closed little fearful group of disciples behind locked doors has become a community of the resurrection, open to the world, hearts wide open. Jesus Christ, as we heard from our colleagues for today, the risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts, that we may seek the good news, good of others, and walk in the joyful road of sacrifice and peace to the praise of God the Father. My friends, ultimately, there are only two types of community on earth. The communities are either closed or open. Closed communities have a centripetal force going on, winding round and round and working the weight itself into the middle, the center of gravity of that closed community.
Close communities tend to hoard love and hoard the grace of God. They're inward looking. The other type of community, the open community, enjoys a centrifugal force where the love that is within you is seen to spread out wider and wider and wider, like a concentric circle, right out to the ends of the world. Love that is not hoarded, but love that is given away freely. That little community locked behind those doors, that fearful community before Pentecost, were close community still. But they became post-Pentecost an open community as they experienced the presence on a daily basis of the crucified and risen Lord. No church is static. It's either becoming more inward-looking, or you see, only the presence of the crucified and risen Jesus can change us to becoming open and moving away from being closed. And the reasons for this are perfectly human and natural, and we're all part of this, because we are a fearful race and we are a tribal people. We fear losing what we know. We fear losing what we love and cherish. But the crucified and risen one has this way. He has this way of continuing to meet us at our point of need, the point that he sees that maybe we don't always see ourselves, the point at where we're at, the point where we need to be opened out more widely. And he moves us forward very, very gently, because he had been a human being, he had walked this earth in flesh and blood, like you and I, tempted like you and I. So he understands our condition. But he appears in our midst when we gather together. He touches our souls when we are on our own. And gently, by a thousand tiny nudges, and by a thousand little epiphanies in different colours, turn out to be the risen Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Receives from our Son, who with the Father. nobody in the world. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, King of righteousness, enthroned at the right hand of the Majesty on high, pray for the world and make it subject to your gentle rule. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Son of Man, drawing humanity into the life of God, pray for your sisters and brothers in need, distress, or sorrow. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus, pioneer of our salvation, bringing us to glory through your death and resurrection, surrounded with your saints and angels, those who have died, trusting your promises. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Lord over all things, ascended far above the heavens and filling the universe, pray for us who receive the gifts you give us for work in your service. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at your feet. For you are alive and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus came and stood amongst them, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of the peace. We sing now. number 271. And anyone who loves the Lord Jesus is welcome to come forward when we restore the communion to receive the bread and the wine. If you prefer just to have a blessing, please keep your hands at your side. Thank you so much.
The joy of the resurrection renews the whole world, while the choirs
can sing forever to your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will not remain.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption as we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of St. George and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Now let us pray with confidence as our Saviour taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Do not presume to come out of this table, blessed Lord.
have assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the death of sin, and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And from page 16, we pray together with your own contemplation. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies, together with the sacrifice. Send us out in the power of the Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. So, our final hymn is hymn number 486, number 486. We have a possible
God the Father, who by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life. God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty,